You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download.
So here, first off, I will talk about my approach to hair roto. While it seems like a daunting task, if you break it down, it's certainly manageable. This time I will show you my hair final right away, explain my process, and then go back to demo actual procedures and techniques. So first I roto the core of the head, separating it into quadrants, or you can choose however many partitions you think will help expedite your process. So I'll just bring up my object list right here. I'm just going to fill it in the trees window. I'm going to turn off all of my other shapes and show you just the hair core. Okay, and I will turn off the hands as well. So now you can see here are my core shapes. So sometimes I do just four quadrants or four shapes, and here I had to add additional outcropping areas for the bangs and the middle side area. In this step, I try to capture as much solid and opaque hair in these shapes. I then roto the larger hair pieces that would be easy to roto with closed shapes. These would be pieces where one can't see through the hair. I arrange these shapes into separate layers from the core, and sometimes in layers relating to different parts of the head, and I'll turn those layers on here. So I'm looking for all the layers that say closed shapes, and we'll just turn on the visibility for those. So now I've added in the closed shapes here. I have my alpha overlay on so you can see them. I'll turn off the outlines. So here are the closed shapes. Of course, there's no blur or motion blur applied at this point. And there's some up here. But that's all I could fit in for closed shapes. I then roto thin pieces of hair that would be more difficult to use an open shape with. With closed shapes, one has more control points to animate, and with open shapes, you just have half as many points. So I'll turn on those layers right now. I'll turn back on the outlines. And I'll turn off the overlay for right now. I roto these shapes in entirety first, and then I assign a width when I'm all done. I keep these groups separate from other hair layers, and sometimes I have multiple layers of open shapes depending on if I need to keep things separate for A, different parts of the head, B, areas that need different widths, and C, if I have variable width shapes. At this stage, none of my open shapes have any widths set to them. Lastly, I add arcs or simple shapes around the core of the head. This is so the hair does not end up looking like sprouts coming out of the head, and I'll turn on that layer. I do try to roto actual hair, so not to make them up as much as possible. And this task can be done pretty easily if one utilizes tracking from the shapes adjacent to the head and where you want them to go. I should also say here that I do all my roto and layer grouping in one node, and when that is final, I duplicate that node. In the second node, I then assign widths to my open shapes. So I'm going to pop off the object list and put it under my trees window again. So I have space for both. So you can see here, I have my roto final for the hair, and I duplicated that. And I now have roto node where I can assign the widths, and I'm going to disable this node right here, so we can just focus on the roto hair assigned widths. Okay, so let me open up some of my open shapes layers, and I can show you how I assign the widths. So first I want to make sure that my shapes are unlocked so I can edit them. So for example, if I'm zoomed in here and I have a width set to 1, let's just check what this is. So my stroke width is at 1. And if I click A, I'm in output so I can see the alpha. And I want to make sure that I turn off the overlays. And now you can see my widths are set there. And it's mostly between like a 1 and a 2 for these open shapes. Some are a little bit thicker than others. It just depends on how thick the hair is on our subject. And for example, if I want to change the width, I can just select everything in one layer, turn back on the outline, the overlays, that part off, and I can just group them, go down to the width, and just to make a real obvious change, I can just change it to 5. So that's easy. If I have everything grouped in different layers, I can easily change the width. So it's thinking, and now I have a really thick stroke there, which I probably don't need, and I can change that back to 1. I also want to point out my organizational structure here. So just move this up here. You can see that I've organized them for different parts of the head. And that way it's not all in one layer. I can edit individual sections really fast. And as you can see, I've also given them different colors. Now that I have assigned widths to all the open shapes, I can move on to the next step. And this is where I've actually duplicated this node once more, and I now have this final node. So I'm going to disable this node here, and we can focus on this node here. This is the third step. I'm going to enable it by clicking the D. It's kind of getting to be a big file when you have open shapes with motion blur and variable widths. It gets a little bit, it can get a little bit slow. So you want to have different options to look at your work. That's why, one of the reasons why I split up my work into 3 different nodes. So if I need to go back and work fast, I can go back and make changes to my first node. Anyhow, so if I click on this node here, you can see in my backdrop, it's where I assign variable widths, assign motion blur, and feathering. So let's dive in here to this node here. So now you can see this is the one layer where I had variable widths, and I'll bring this up and we'll find that layer. There's a lot of shapes in here. Let's just expand that. Okay, open shapes variable. So if I toggle down, you can see here. So even though I had tracking applied, there's lots of keyframes, and I want to make sure that I have the correct roto shapes that are animating properly. So you can see it's a little bit slow because I have everything turned on. You can see I've enabled motion blur here and also in the node. If I click on the node properties, actually what I need to do is, let me just expand this a little bit more and go back to this section here and to the parameters and enable the motion blur here. And I've also upped my samples, so it's a little bit less bandy, less stair-stepping. So having variable widths are kind of nice. It's kind of in between an open shape and a closed shape. So if you want to see how I do this, I'm just gonna go back to my interim node here, and I'll just show you how I assign a variable width. I'm going to unlock the node here. I'm going to just choose one of these shapes here. So the shapes coming out of her body right here, or her head, they kind of start thick and they go thin. I don't really want to have an open shape, and let's just crank our viewer a little bit so we can see a little bit better. So I roto the shapes and then I assign the width. Okay, so let's select one of these in points mode. Actually, let's select this one. And we'll make sure that it's unlocked. If you can't select something, just go through and make sure that everything is unlocked. Okay, let's select this again. And we're in shape. Okay, so now I'm going to click Alt-F, and that's going to bring up the feathering option as soon as I assign a width. So if I go in here and I assign a width, let's do... We'll start with 3. And it's thinking, okay, now we have our width, but it's thinner at the bottom here and thicker at the top. When I click on one of these points, and now I click Alt F, you can see I have two handles. The green is the feather handle and the blue is the width. And this handle will be the same color as the spline. So if we just pull that out, and actually what I want to do, instead of just on this frame, I'm just going to Control Z. I'm going to click M. So now I'm in multi-frame. So it's going to do every frame that has a keyframe. And I'm going to expand that out. And it just takes a little time. And now you can see that my shape's going to be thicker at the top, closer to the head. And it definitely takes time. Your computer's processing all of this at once. Okay, I'm going to go with that. I'm going to click M to get out of multi-frame. And the red will disappear. And now if I go to a different keyframe, you can see that I have a variable open shape.